attending. I know it's the first day of classes, which is a busy day for everyone in the semester, but I'm happy to see you here. It is my pleasure to introduce our two speakers for this evening, who have just come from a very marathon genetics meeting in San Diego and agreed to swing by and give a talk here before they fly back to Israel tomorrow afternoon. So I would like to present Professor Avi Gopher, who is a professor of archaeology at the Tel Aviv University, and his colleague Shahal Abo, who is an agronomist at the Levi School of Agriculture at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, but he's actually based in Rehovot. So they are both experts at this point. They've been publishing for 2 decades. I think we just discerned over coffee that your first publication together was in 2000.
Yeah.
So they've been working together for a number of years, tackling the ever-popular and much-debated issue of plant domestication in the Near East, which I know many of you guys are well aware of, especially those many of you who I've forced to read many of the articles, including those published by our esteemed speakers for today. And they are going to be talking today about some revolutionary ideas on the Neolithic Revolution, a different perspective on traditional approaches to understanding plant domestication, which I noted in a recent press coverage we described as a process, not a traffic accident. So they're talking about research they've been doing together for many years, and was recently published in a book called Plant Domestication and the Origins of Agriculture in the Near East that was published by Resling and Hebrew Press. And so without further ado, I could go on and on about the publications, but they are both literally more than my arms length. So I will let them speak on their topic, Plant Domestication in the Near East. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Lisa for myself and on behalf of my partner, Professor Shahal Abo, for the opportunity to be here. And our topic today is plant domestication in the Near East. Plant domestication is part of a transformation that is known as the agricultural revolution, which is an overarching change in human perception and social economy, a major cultural turning point in human history. We would like to present some aspects of plant domestication and plant domestication research in the Near East, and if time permits, contemplate on their significance in shaping our here and now. We will present two perspectives of plant domestication in the Near East. One, a cultural one, that is changes in culture as seen through the archaeological record. And the second will be presented by Shahal and relates to biological aspects that are relevant to the species that we talk about. In our case, it's a package of 8 species that were domesticated, including legumes and cereals. These two things related into each other, so it's not a holy division. Our goal here this evening is to try and convince you that the model of plant domestication in the Near East that we support is of higher parsimony when compared to other models, which I will present very soon. For those of you who do not closely follow plant domestication research in the Near East, let me just present 2 or 3 points as a short background. First point, at least the protagonist in this main of plant domestication in the Near East. It includes archaeologists investigating culture, archaeobotanists who investigate plant remains recovered in archaeological sites, biologists and geneticists investigating crop plant genetics, agronomists studying crop adaptation and husbandry, and geobotanists studying the environment and the ecology of the relevant plants. A good script for this play would be, in my view, based on creating a trustful interrelationship between three major actors. That is the biology, the environment of plants and man, and man's culture, so that a synergetic interplay will take place between these actors, creating a world that is hopefully bigger than the sum of its parts. The second point I want to talk about is the two models that are on stage now. The first one, which we call the protracted, autonomous, or non-centered model, is the one thriving in Eastern Neolithic studies in the past decade. This model emphasizes a long, protracted process that was B, geographically autonomous, that is non-centered, and characterized by C, an unconscious nature. On the other hand, is the co-area one-event model that views Near Eastern Neolithic plant domestication as a knowledge-based and conscious event occurring in a geographically limited core area and during a very short single event. Although we think the second model is, in our view, corroborated by multiple lines of evidence, including archaeological evidence, archaeobotanical and genetic evidence, it currently represents a minority view, and you should know that. And the third point that I want to introduce as part of this introduction is that you may have noticed that these the models, as they stand, present a set of dichotomies, as their names indicate. And when looked at in more detail, these include, amongst others, some paired issues that we should at least mention. There's the question of locality. Did plant domestication take place in a specific, well-defined core area within the Levant, which means it was highly localized, or did it occur independently or autonomously in different places, and it was a diffused model? And had it been centered, where was the area it took place? Second point is the process itself. Did domestication occur in an exclusive single episode for each species and as a whole, which I would say is a part of the view of singular timing, or were there multiple domestication per species and thus by definition for the package as a whole? This raises a question concerning the issue of how did Neolithic package coalesce. Then there is an issue of intent. Was the process incidental or circumstantial, or a result of evolutionary mutualism, or was it a designated knowledge-based human initiative? And there is a point of selection, where the choices of plant species to be domesticated and the selection of phenotypes or specific types to be domestication, to be domesticated, conscious or unconscious. And the last is the length of the process. Was it a fast process or an event, an episode if you want, which is possibly not easily recognized by the resolution we have for archaeological find, or was it a millennia-long protracted process? While it is difficult to separate the answer to these distinct but yet interrelated questions, we would argue that making a decision in favor of a localized core area option, as we did in the past, looking like this, green circle, can this choice can take the balance concerning undecided paired topics and help in creating a coherent cultural and biological scenario of plant domestication at the Near East. This scenario would accord well with the current available data. On the other hand, opting for the alternative geographically diffused or autonomous model of independent domestication processes for each plant and in different locales within the Near East raises difficulties and leaves many unresolved questions. Just another last note. We know that researchers in recent years tend to view cultural processes, domestication of plants and animals included, of course, within a macroevolutionary historical perspective, and as a continuous process comprising habitual fluid sequences of sociocultural environments, as it was called by, for example, the name of Zedel or Elenia Sutil or others. Or, in other words, the interaction between man and plants, again, domestication included, is viewed basically as a continuum of transitional situation. These researchers oppose either or dualist type of traditions. We will nevertheless introduce views of such paired dichotomies with respect to plant domestication as they are a comfortable device. It's easy to use. I decided to focus on the where question. Is there a center of domestication? And if so, where is this center in the Near East? I will, of course, try to convince you that there is a center, there is a core area, and that it is in the northern parts of the Levant, in southeastern Turkey, and northern Syria. And you can see in the map, it's still on. I will focus on the cultural background of plant domestication and try to provide a picture of how the archaeological or cultural landscapes of these immense historical processes looked like in the Near East in the relevant time period. It is a telegraphic view, somewhat simplified, a bit jumpy, and it is based on visible material culture, but I suppose that these material culture elements reflect changes in perceptions and in ideology as well. These changes transforming man or man world or nature culture relationships from a hunter-gatherer state of affairs described years ago by Tim Engel as a state of trust to food-producing state described by him as a state of domination. I think it was in the year 2000 when this paper was published. So here we go. Let's first have a very brief look at major aspects that differentiate hunter-gatherers from food-producing farmers. This is, of course, a generalization. Hunters and gatherers differ from food-producing farmers in settlement patterns and mobility. They differ in social structure, they differ in economy, they differ in demography, and they differ in perception. They differ in perception or man-world relationship, if you want to call it that way. All these represent a deep divide or a major perceptual and structural difference. And it is expressed in the low, in terms of what we are looking for, or the very low ecological footprint of hunters-gatherers. They leave very little of this in the world, while the footprint of food producers, that is us, keeps growing, maybe to a point of low return. Now, how do these aspects look like in the archaeological landscape? Let's have a brief look at man's footprint in the landscape from above as the eagle flies. And I'll do it short and fast. If we take a look at the present, Bushman camp, or 20th century Bushman camp, and look at one hut and the camp as a whole, this is what we see. Then we take our first flight some 23,000 years ago above Israel, looking at the site of Tohelo near the Sea of Galilee. And we look at a hut. This is what remained of it. And this is how it was reconstructed. And we see a site or a camp as a whole. And I think you may notice the similarities in these two situations. Now we take another flight around 15,000 years ago, looking at the Natufian culture of northern Israel, and what we can see is stone houses, quite large houses, and dense sites with a lot of architecture. We can see heavy facilities in these houses, and between them we can see on-site burials. This is another site. And we can see a rich array of ancient items or art, if you want to call it art, that wasn't there before or was not so intensive. Now we take another flight around 11,500 years ago, when the preparatory Neolithic age period starts. That's the very beginning of the Neolithic period. And we see intensive settlements with mud brick and stone rounded houses in large sites like Jericho, which is 10 acres. 14 tunas. It's a big site. A large site like this, and you can see the you can see these houses in different PPNA sites, like Netiv Abdul, like Nahal Oren, like Jerfin Ahmar in Syria, and many more. Maybe Neolithic towns like Jericho, with massive walls around, with a ditch around the site, and with these rounded, large towers. We take another flight above Göbekli Tepe, site in Turkey, in the northern Levant, around 11,000 to 10,500 years ago, just a minute before domestication. And what we see there is an overwhelming growth, an abnormal condition, if you want to call it like this, for hunters gatherers. A manifestation of change in man-world relations. It's an immense site, 15 hectares. There's a very large invested stone-built enclosures that look like this. Some of them can reach a diameter of 20 or over 20 meters. There's another one. The big stone masses you see in there are monumental imagery items, very big sculptures made of stone. These we call them T-shaped stone pillars, and this is monumental sculpting, and includes many images of animal representations, mostly animals, and some of them are three-dimensional. Abnormal, but I'm not sure about that. This growth in scale represents a climax of sorts of hunters gatherer societies in this region, but it was not accompanied by a change in economy. There's no evidence for domestication. This may have caused inevitable pressures, which may, at least partly, explain why hunter-gatherers have changed their worldviews. Let us take our last flight after the PPLA, after the beginning of the Neolithic, And after looking at this outstanding site, let me take another flight around 10,600 years ago to 10,000 years ago. We look at looking at the landscapes of people who domesticated plants and animals in a period, let me call early PPNB. We can observe a real turning point here and a new landscape. This is expressed in many realms of culture and in the archaeological arena as well. We can see a new site nature, large, very large farming societies that look like this when reconstructed. This is a tradition of village life, so well known in Western images as we think about it. We can see a real change in architecture. There is no architecture. It's not rounded as it used to be for millennia, but now it's rectangular architecture. It includes domestic buildings, like this one at Çanakkale in Turkey. It includes also public architecture. This one too is from Çanakkale, and it's called the Skull House, and it has many, many skeletons in one of its parts. Or like it was interpreted as a temple in the site of Nivelle on the Euphrates. And this appears in many more sites. There's also a new economy in the early PPNB, and it's based on domesticates. These are the first domesticates found in the archaeological record. There are also new technologies, such as light cluster. This is a building cluster from Israel a bit later. This is the earliest biotechnology we know in the Neolithic period. There are new technologies for making blades. These blades are used for making sickle blades and arrowheads, new types of grinding stones, new storage facilities, some aspects of water control, and many more technological innovations. There are also new burial practices that can be observed with new treatments of the dead. And there is a new imagery, or art, if you want to call it art, with more anthropomorphous than zoomorphous representations like it was before. And this example is for Nivelle Çukuru on the Euphrates. The early PPNB people and their predecessors of the pre-pottery Neolithic period materialized the change, establishing fully agricultural systems that spread throughout the Near East and beyond. Although a very brief survey, it is clear that something significant was taking place just after the PPNA has finished and the early PPNB started around 10,600 or 10,500 years. By 10,000 years ago, lifeways based on domesticates and farming villages were fully established in the Near East of the region almost everywhere. Just a brief run. Later in the Neolithic, further new technologies appear, accompanied by new burial customs, sometimes looking like this, especially in the southern Levant, plastered skulls. And then new perceptions regarding social ranking that starts appearing, gender systems and religion. Later on, some new paraphernalia, some stone masks from the PPNB. Later on, pottery appears, and somewhat later, metallurgy, copper, and then gold. Then urbanization and cities with chiefs or kings and taxes, and priests and temples, with generals and armies, and so on, to our modern condition, if you want to call it that way. Quite a series, a whole series of revolutions. If we try to touch some of these changes and relevant archaeological and archaeobotanical finds and results of biological genetic analysis, to the question of plant domestication in the Near East. And if we compile all these, this evidence that supports plant domestication in the northern Levant core area, what we suggest at the beginning of the early PPMB, the list would look like this. There will be geobotanical evidence to show that this is the only ridge where all the wild progenitors of the eight packaged species appear. But this one, that I mentioned earlier, if we look at the archaeology, the suggested core area in southeastern Turkey and northern Syria was a major active cultural center for Neolithic innovations and materials that spread to other parts of the Levant and beyond. This is supported by carbon-14 dates, recording the flow of pre-pottery Neolithic cultural elements from the northern Levant to the south and west. This area has also exhibited a shift in site character, as I've shown before, architecture, burial, custom, economy, and many material aspects, as well as in imagery items and symbolism, climaxing in the early PPMB with a clear, direct, and well-dated evidence of plant and animal domestication. To make this statement, one has to use the proper available resolution, which I'll deal with or say more about later on before we finish. Also, there is archaeobotanical evidence, and the archaeobotanical evidence is very clear. It is found for all packaged species in their wild form in the core area region in the Lake Natufian and in the PPMB. So they're wild up until around 10,006 or 10,500 years ago. And then we get the earliest evidence for domestication for domesticated plants in this area around 10,500 years ago. And this is the earliest evidence we have for domestication. There is also genetic evidence that indicates that the genetic stocks of the progenitors of several packaged species that gave rise to the domesticated populations and forms are present in only a limited area of their broad distribution in the suggested core area. This is the case for emmerwheat, for anchorwheat, for chickpea, and for lentil. And as recently shown, it's true for pea and barley as well, although barley is a more complicated story with other possible domestications. We don't have good evidence for flax, that is part of the package, and for bitter veg. There's also the story of faba bean that appears from the very beginning, but we don't know its progenitors, so it's hard to talk about. There's one additional point I want to show in favor of the core area model. It is the pattern of spread of domesticated and farming as seen by archaeological, archaeobotanical, and carbon-14 dating. This is very relevant to the choice between the two models I presented before, since the core area one-event model predicts quite clearly the spread of domesticated plant populations from a center of domestication, i.e. southern Turkey and northern Syria, southeastern Turkey, that can be detected by temporal spatial patterns found within the archaeological and archaeobotanical assembly. And it can also be followed by the genetic footprints of introgression that can be detected by the pattern of DNA polymorphism among respective populations. So the protracted autonomous model is expected to leave no such spatial patterns, neither among the archaeological or archaeobotanical record, nor among DNA polymorphism data. For wheat and chickpea, based on available molecular genetic data, as well as on archaeobotanical remains, this may be described as a ripple or wave of advanced pattern radiating out of the proposed core area. These ripples are also notable, and the works of other researchers, notwithstanding the domestication model they endorse. And, indeed, the spread of domesticated plants within the Levant or the Near East is in line with the spread of other cultural elements. Interestingly, this seems to be the case for animals too. This is taken from a paper about Alindo Zitter about a decade ago. It's true for animals, the progenitors of all four animals domesticated, sheep, goat, cattle, and pig, overlap in the area that is quite similar and quite close to the core area we suggest. It's also true for some linguistics, especially concerning the source of Indo-European languages. It's also true for human genetic studies in the last 2 or 3 years that indicate populations with agriculture that spread from this area to the west and into Europe. In conclusion, my answer to the question where is that there was a core area in the northern Levant on the Middle Euphrates where farming has started, and there is evidence for it fast spread within the Near East and beyond. Also, within the next 2,500 years, major parts of Europe, Western Asia, and North Africa will become agricultural. One of the reasons why this model with these multiple lines of evidence is still a minority view relates to the fact that many of the actors in the play of plant domestication in the Near East ignore a major distinction, that is the distinction between plant domestication itself and crop evolution under domestication that follows domestication. And Shahan will be talking about that. And I will summarize and take the word.
So this will be my part of the talk. What is the difference between plant domestication and crop evolution? And how is it possible to distinguish between the two? And I will briefly talk about these three topics, the domestication symbol, try to distinguish between these two concepts, and if we have time, and if you are interested also in the agronomic aspects of it, we can also discuss the implications for modern living. So the domestication symbol is a concept that was coined by Karl Hammer, a botanist, in 1984. One of the possible define it as written here, a suite of traits that are essential for the survival of the plant in the wild, and which a genetic change can be seen in domesticated forms. And it is interesting that conceptual infrastructure for this definition, for coining this concept, was made a decade earlier in 1973 by Jack Harman in a classical paper, The Comparative Evolution of Cereals. And these are basically the traits, and he called it an adaptation symbol, because it means that the plants were made adapted into the man-made environment, that is the cultivated field. And the most important and most highly discussed traits in that long list are the non-shattering of upper groups, disabling of the dispersal mode of the seeds, seed size, larger organs in domesticated plants, and loss of germination. So let's go into it. How does it look like? This is how shattering of wild wheat spikes look like. These are the propagules, the spikelets, and this is a wild pea. The pods shatter, and most of the seeds are shot out of it. Sometimes you can just see, They come around and they catch one or two. So these two phenotypes look similar. Actually, they are parallel. Okay. Bear this in mind. However, looking at the dormancy phenotype of legume seeds, Guido Radzinski, who was my PhD supervisor, in 87 suggested a sort of turned it upside down and said pulse domestication before cultivation. And that is making the claim that a free germinating stock is essential, actually imperative, for cultivating legumes, because those plants have seed germination at the rate of 90%. That would be only 10% of them after maturing by the end of the summer. Only 10% of them will germinate with the autumn rain. So he was going and visiting wild populations and in autumn and try to follow this simple explanation. An average lentil plant in Israel and Jordan and Lebanon makes about 10 seeds. If you plant 100 seeds in your cultivator, only 10 will germinate, each will reproduce by a factor of 10, you end up with 100 seeds. So you end up with what you invest. Under such circumstances, there is no incentive for cultivation. So if one identifies, apparently they were able to do it, free germinating stock, that is a domesticated phenotype in the wild, what people call standing genetic variation, you adopt it, only then you can start talking about cultivation. But this concept was rejected, and people maintain and looking and seeing the parallelism or the so-called parallel between the domestication of legumes and cereals. So a few years ago, more than 10 years ago, we decided to look into this question of the so-called parallelism between legumes and cereals. And this is actually, this endeavor helped us to try and distinguish between this pair that Avi has mentioned, between the two opposing views concerning the mode or the mechanism, the biological mechanism of domestication. Avi was discussing the cultural aspects. Let us look at the biological aspects. So if you try and compare the biological features of these two plant groups that make the founder crop package, the cereals and the legumes, and again, as I mentioned earlier, the central dogma, if I may use it, was that the domestication went parallel in these two groups. But if you look at the population structure, here it is patchy and thin. These are massive. We don't have time to look at all of this. It was all published. In terms of plant stature, these are short caping plants. Cereals are tall plants. They can be, 2 meters high. In terms of growth habit, these have an indeterminate growth habit. These have determinate growth habit. For those of you who are not biologists, cereal plants, the growth ends with a spike, the inflorescence. On a pea plant or a lentil plant, you get the flowers and leaf axils. So there is a continuum of growth and of vegetative and reproductive growth at the same time. In terms of the dispersal rate, you saw the difference. These are cornflake seeds that cannot be gathered from the ground. These are own spikelets, sometimes including the owns 15 centimeters long, even after shuttering. You can harvest or you can collect some material. In terms of seed dormancy, here it is in the range of 90%, here it's only 50%. In the floral biology, cleistogamous means that fertilization takes place within the flowers. The anthers shed their pollen in those legumes, okay, because they are cross-pollinated legumes, but I'm talking about those Middle Eastern plants before the petals open, so there is hardly any chance for cross-pollination. The cereals have special designated organs that actually open the florets and enable, if there is any airborne pollen, some degree of cross-pollination. And the result, the end result, again, in agronomic terms, when you combine all those traits, the overall effect on the phenotype and the performance of the plants is that the cereals have aggressive growth, and legumes are very poor competitors in terms of their ability to grow. So you see, these are dramatically different worlds, and there is no possibility that the same attitude, same agronomic attitude that was applied for cereals domestication, it wouldn't have worked with the legumes. So our conclusion from this is that the biology was entirely different. But let's just look at dormancy. We conducted field experiments with three species, and we had two treatments: scarified seeds, that is taking a piece of the seed coat. This is releases the actually allows the seeds to imbibe water, and therefore to get full establishment, nearly 100% germination. We did it during 3 years in three sites in Israel, and this is how the nurseries look during the harvest. And just to summarize, you know, you end up with a field that looks like a checkered plate. Each such square was sown with wild seeds that were not scarified. Like, this is the natural situation, and these green plots are either wild that were scarified or domesticated chicks. So if you look at it, the mean grain yield, of course, with the domesticated chicks is pretty high. Wild pea, even suffering considerable loss because of shattering, because they have shattering pods. Okay, these are the yield numbers between 280 and 170. And these are the intact wild, namely the dormant. In most of the cases, the yield is, and we had to invest 40 grams in each plot. So the yield is very close to what you invest, just like the theoretical considerations of Ladyzhinsky. He never made any experiment. He was satisfied with making the calculation, but we did that. So if you look at it, we can actually declare or make the claim that free germination or loss of dormancy is a crucial or a critical trait for domestication. Okay? And of course, and again, we don't have the time to talk about it, this renders the concept of pre-domestication, cultivation, totally irrelevant, actually removes it from the scene of the play that Avi was trying to put the script. Okay? But still, in the plant domestication literature concerning the Near East, it is a major theme to this very day. So, because some of the traits that are bunched under the umbrella of the domestication syndrome, some of them can be seen as crucial or critical, and some of them can be seen as useful but not critical. We thought that it is useful to try and develop a reliable distinction between such traits. And also, you have to bear in mind that some of the traits that are visible for us today with living plants are actually irrelevant or are basically transparent when you look at them through an archaeological perspective. For instance, all those phenotypes okay? Like germinization response in chickpea, or free, or germination, or dormancy, or in legumes, or in cereals, and the growth habit. This cannot be inferred from child seeds or from other archaeobotanical plant remains. So, and also to make, to emphasize this point that if you accept, if you give me this credit, and if you accept the concept of genuine domestication traits or crucial domestication traits, crucial in terms of the agronomic value, okay, to enable profitable cultivation, then it would immediately follow that all the other traits, like these ones, for example, or part of these ones, are post-domestication changes, and therefore should be regarded as crop evolution, okay, rather than domestication. So, and again, our observation, and this is not universal. It may not apply to each and every plant from each and every domestication center, but it may well be applied to many of the domesticated plants, and we think it is useful. In most of the cases, the genetic basis of those crucial, or what we call genuine domestication traits, is monogenic. These are Mendelian changes that are controlled by genes of major effect, and usually the plant material, like the archaeobotanical material, can be classified very easily into two categories with hardly any intermediates. Okay, like Mendel peas, either pink or white. Archaeobotanical remains of cereal spikelets, either a rough scar or a smooth scar. Okay, and when you look at the living wheat plants, either shattering or non-shattering, with hardly any intermediates. And again, this is the action of a major gene, a Mendelian trait. And while the other traits that are often used to so-called document domestication or changes in domestication, like Doyle Fuller's reports on seed size in wheat and the changes of seed sizes in barley, those are polygenic traits. Those are not monogenic traits. Okay? So, and they cannot be classified into categories, and of course need a different set of statistical tools to. So if you look, for example, in wheat, there is an overlap. When you look at the phenotypes of wild wheat and domesticated wheat, there is an overlap. So if you have a seed remain of 35 milligrams, is it wild or domesticated? How can you tell? And if you look, so people may have well selected for larger seed size. We are not excluding this option. But when you are given a specimen, you can't say anything about its domestication status. Okay, no matter where it falls on those scatter plots. Okay? And the same goes with chickpea. Okay? There are chickpea cultivars that have seeds that are smaller than Cicer reticulatum, the white progenitor. Okay? So we cannot use seed size in chickpea to document domestication. So can be formulated in this manner, that genuine domestication traits are mostly monomorphic, both within the domesticated gene pool and the wild gene pool, but with alternative alleles in each gene pool. And while traits that are polymorphic in both gene pools, okay, we would exclude them from the domestication episode, or we would suggest that if they had any role, they had a minor role, and they cannot be used to, they shouldn't be associated with the domestication episode. However, a trait like seed size is a very useful descriptor of crop evolution, because breeders today in Syngenta keep on trying and improve those traits, increase the seed size, increase the yield, and improve the phenotypes. So it's a different concept. Rather than documenting domestication, metric traits like seed size and other phenotypes are powerful and useful descriptors of crop evolution under domestication, which is by definition a never-ending process that goes on even today. And actually, you can make predictions and put it in such an orthogonal table in terms of the polymorphism pattern within the wild gene pool, the domesticated gene pool, domestication traits and crop evolution traits. And here you expect them both to be monomorphic, but with alternative allele, here non-shattering, here of course spontaneous seed dispersal, here polymorphic, like for instance a range of karyotypes and blastos, like what you see in wild lentils, but monomorphic, a single karyotype, a single blaston, that's the chloroplast genome. And when we talk about, so here it would be polymorphic, here it would be monomorphic. In terms of crop evolution, you expect certain traits to be polymorphic. Again, a range of seed sizes, and here again, as I demonstrated, a range of seed sizes. And also the opposite, look at this. There is, of course, the possibility that the wild will be monomorphic and the domesticated will be polymorphic. Think about the cabbages. All wild cabbages look the same, and they don't have a cabbage head. But within the same botanical species, we have russet sprouts, kale, kohlrabi, cauliflower, and cabbage. They are all the same species. You can cross hybridize all of them and have fertile. And they belong to the same species. So this is the situation here. They are monomorphic in the wild, but highly polymorphic within the domesticated gene pool. So in many, many cases, this distinction works well. And as I said, it will not work for mango, for example. Okay, and may not work for date palm. But it works for very many crop plants from the Near East and from other centers. So we propose to conceptualize this issue in such a manner, that there was an episodic stage of domestication in which those guys from the early and from the middle people in this story had to deal with the crucial traits, and later on, this is crop evolution, what we still do today, and it is ongoing. Some people call it improvement. Jeff Ross Ibarra from Davis called those traits improvement traits. Okay. So that's this is what, and just to add to what Ali mentioned, if you want to choose the protracted, autonomous, diffuse alternative of those two models, just bear in mind that it is founded on those assumptions, the assumption of the necessity of pre-domestication cultivation. It doesn't work with legumes. Circular argumentation concerning means of cultivation, we don't have time, only if you insist on asking about the virus or how you insist. Assuming that the early cultivators were unable to distinguish between brittle and unbrittle cereals growing in their field, erroneous assumption about workload involved in post-harvest processing of the considered those linear regression changes of seed size over time, which again are meaningless, as I showed earlier, and ignoring the fact that there is no biological option for pre-domestication cultivation of grain legumes, and ignoring evidence of rapid shifted domestication based on the seed shape that are rounded from tender, which is particularly so. All in all, that protracted alternative actually confuses between plant domestication and broad evolution. So, and the use for it, or the use that we can make out of it as plant breeders or agronomists, is that because we, you know, domestication involved actually sampling from the wild. So people talk about the domestication both from the crop plants are less diverse genetically, notwithstanding this cabbage story. So we need to resort to wild germplasm and to improve disease resistance or pest resistance or protein content in seeds. But if you think about a crucial trait and a non-crucial trait, okay, when you think about genetic erosion along or across the chromosomal regions, if you look at the chromosomal region where a domestication trait, a genuine domestication trait, resides, the locus, the genetic locus, the value, the potential value of this chromosomal segment would be high for breeding. But if you look at an improvement rate, the potential value of the chromosomal segment would be rather low. So there is actually a practical use for this concept in plant breeding as well. And I think that now we should go on.
So, so just to finish up, I'll make a summary note about resolution, because what you were listening to in the last 15 or 20 minutes was all about resolution. We may say that not a few of the biologists, geneticists, agronomists investigating plant domestication are striving for increased resolution. They do it by refining their knowledge and understanding of, for example, what Chahan was talking about before, the domestication syndrome for cereals and legumes, or by distinguishing plant domestication from crop evolution. The funny or sad story is that, on the other hand, not a few of the archaeologists and archaeobotanists that deal with plant domestication in the Near East and in other places, very surprisingly, go the other way. And instead of increasing their resolution, they lower it by way of lumping large units of time and by downing the cultural picture and viewing the interaction between man and plants, including domestication, as a fluid, indistinct continuum of transitional situations. Thereby, they are inevitably losing the reference to the archaeological data, and they are wasting the efforts made by generations of archaeologists to provide a higher resolution. The archaeological or cultural blocks used for the protracted, non-centered, unconscious plant domestication model are too big, or in other words, based on too low a resolution to withstand any scientific scrutiny. So for us, we are splitters. We believe in using high resolution possible. Now, since the archaeological work in the Eastern Neolithic archaeology provides a plus or minus 25, plus or minus 50, was a large plus or minus 100 years of cultural resolution of this period, we reject any lumping as is common in plant domestication research of the nearest nowadays. A conspicuous example that I can give you for this lumping is the pooling together of the PPNA that I presented before and the PPNB. This way, we actually subdivide the neolithic part relevant to plant domestication into two blocks of 11 to 1400 years each, which means we are way, way, way beyond the resolution we can use. Now, this low resolution hinders the opportunity to put under any scrutiny the very details of this cultural, or these cultural histories that we are discussing. Lacking a subdivision between the PPNA and the early PPNB, they lose the respective uniqueness of the cultural units they boast, and a most significant cultural and economic border is being blurred, or actually we are losing. Moreover, this practice of lumping exposes any discussion of the cultural viewpoint to statements such as this one that we see on the slide, which in my view represent a loss of resolution that renders much of the good work of archaeologists irrelevant or redundant altogether. Now, the protracted autonomous model of plant domestication flourishes at this low resolution. It's a good environment to talk about long processes, and you don't need to go into details and use the resolution available. This way of doing things is divorced from some of the available archaeological and biological data, as well as from the agronomy of the package crop and crop lands. On the other hand, the core area one event model cannot, by definition, give up high resolution or and praise blurring of the picture, but it should rather have to look at things very carefully and look for the exact cultural context in which things are happening and point out the point in time where the earliest evidence of domestication appears. That is according to most of the evidence we have now on the Near East, happened around 10,500 years ago in the northern Levant, southeastern Turkey, and northern Syria. Thank you very much.
Any climate changes we've got here in the agriculture emergency?
Well, as you might guess, we started by trying what we know about climate change, that is the holy argument, the problem, and demography, that's the other holy. So, we learned that demography did not take high growth right at the time to domesticate, but it has a retardation effect. It starts later. We know it from other demographic models now, and it was shown to be true in different continents. As for climate, many of the people that used to argue that climate is a reason for change in the economy realize now that in the Near East, the major event you can talk about or climatological aspect you can talk about is the Younger Dryas. The Younger Dryas starts around 13,000 years ago, maybe a bit later, ends around 100,000 years ago, maybe a bit later. So it has no relevance to plant domestication whatsoever. And there is one claim by Gordon Hillman, an old claim about Lake Natufian 13,000 years old domestication of rye.
Now, the size of fossil
nobody accepts it, and it was working very well with the Younger Dryas, but it was pushed too far, and it doesn't work. So actually, we don't have any articulation between what happened in the climatological record and plant domestication and animal domestication. So what happened in the last 5 years is that people start going back. And what they say is this: okay, we can see the younger grass in the record, but we are not sure that it was so dramatic in the southern Levant. It's very local. Maybe, basically, if you lower the average temperature and you decrease the amount of precipitation, you have two compensating things, because you have less precipitation, you have a lower temperature. The major problem with water availability in the Near East is evaporation. So if you lower the temperature and you lower with precipitation, nothing special happens to the environment, and we know it from the paleontological record, from the botanical record, from the fauna remains, we know. I'm not saying there is no younger grass. There is a clear younger grass in the record. It has no relevancy, honestly, to plant or animal domestication. It's earlier, it's much earlier. And so people start talking about time of plenty and domesticating while everything was okay. We were all in leisure and having fun.
So, in your opinion, what was the cause?
If I have to be bold and answer in one word, the cause is perception. It's in people's minds. You cannot domesticate clearly animals, but I think plants as well. If your mind is working like a hunter-gatherer mind, it's impossible. The whole ethos of existence will not let you do it. So you have to first, like Jacques Covin said many years ago in his amazing book about the birth of the gods and the Neolithic era, the agricultural revolution, he said, you have to have a change in your psychology, a change in your perception before you start domesticating, because you cannot do it as a hunter and gatherer. It's against your ethos of existence. So the reason why, this is the reason why. Now, I've shown empirically to you, it's crazy to see something like this in the Near East, around 11,000 years old, maybe a little later, and there's no domesticants. Maybe they will find some, they're continuing working, although the excavator, the original excavator, has passed away. But as for now, there's no evidence for domestication there. You don't have any evidence before the early PPNB. So something must have happened to people that drove them into a perceptual change. And Gebekli is a very good example of that, because this is not typical hunter-gatherer scales. It's abnormal. It's really not logical to see that. And so a lot of people were talking at the beginning, saying, oh, well, it's aggregation site, and there are farmers already. But there's no evidence. Some archaeobotanical material was studied. The fauna, some of the fauna was studied. There's no evidence for domestication whatsoever. So it must be here. And this is why we think it's knowledge-based, and it's intentional, and it's conscious, and it's etc. etc.
Thank you.
Thank you.
But I wanted to talk, if you wouldn't mind, about legumes and down specific. I mean, the classic that you use, that people use, is the brittle rake peas, and that's really clear, and it's one trait, and it's kind of, you can get your hands and your mind around it. But the legumes are a little bit slippery. So when you talk about seed dormancy, as, I mean, if I'm not mistaken, a few slides ago, you were summarizing, and you were making your single, it's not polymorphic, but you know, I don't know how many genes are involved, but you focused on seed dormancy. Now, in my mind, seed dormancy is testaficus. Are you using something different for that, and what are your monogenetics for seed dormancy?
Well, in many green legumes, dormancy is mediated by thick seed coat and thick stalk. That's correct. There are examples of some species. For one gene, there are examples these.
In legumes,
not for tester thickness, for the ability of the seeds to imbibe water and germinate. I mean, the measure, actually, what matters for the cultivator is whether you get a good stand.
Right.
So they put them on moist filter paper and count the seeds. So this is what they measure. Okay, so there are examples of, as I said, of monogenic, degenic in Vizia, I think. There are, what you measure or the numbers that you get sometimes depend on the methodology that you are using. So, for instance, when people do Mendelian genetics and try to classify the plants, like you take a dormant genotype and a non-dormant genotype, you cross them and you test the progeny. This is the way we do it. If you apply a QTM approach, it is possible to identify sometimes even 7 or 8 genetic loci that have some effect on dormancy that may be used to explain, let's say, 2%, 5%, 17%, or 40% of the variation. This is, you may find this acronym PEV, percentage of explained variation in the progeny. But again, I would make the claim that in order to enable profitable cultivation, all I need is to bring the rate of germination from the natural 10% to about 30 or 40. All the rest can follow suit. So you need one critical change.
One critical change, but there are several that could be triggered. So that makes
a definition. By definition, almost every biological phenotype is affected by a multitude of genes and their
interaction. You're making a case for this one critical gene that changes, and that's what I'm working on with my legumes. Because I can see it with the brittle legumes, but you're saying that there's multiple genes, and all you need is one of those to change. It's going to shift the genetic dormancy.
One critical trait.
Right.
I don't know if it's necessarily one gene.
It could be a change
from multiple genes.
Let me rephrase it. It may well be that the critical change would be just one change, one mutation in one of those genes. Okay. For instance, in barley, we know that there are two, and they are linked, two loci of brittle legumes. But you need only one change in either BR1 or BR2, and you get the domesticated phenotype. You don't need the two of them to be charged.
I want to add
something that Shafal said that relates to your question. Now, it's a matter of what you think about people. When you talk about dormancy and say it's critical, what it means in my terms, I'm not a biologist, is that if you say that there is protracted processes that take thousands of years of people trying to or having a process of domestication, what you say is that in all these sites, all of them having lentil, there were stupid people that were working all day, all season, all year, and making no profit. If everything was okay, they put in 100 and they get back 100. And if it's not okay, they get back 50. This is not logical for people who made all these things. I mean, you can lose a crop 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years. How long can you work without a profit?
Well, you move on.
You move on where?
Physically.
But there are lentils all over. But there are lentils all over the place, everywhere, with the domesticated package. All sites have lentils. Now you say maybe they collected them in the wild. Yeah, but if you say that they were cultivating for thousands of years, and you get lentil everywhere, so what did? Did they go just to collect lentils? We collected lentils. You have to be on your knees to find a small plant with 10. You have to work all day.
You have to work all day for a cup of soup. It's not, I mean, unless you do that in the water. This is not expectable for hunters gatherers. In terms of what people were doing when they were domesticated, it's impossible that it's a long process because it doesn't work for legumes. It doesn't work. Unless you think that they're stupid enough to do it for thousands of years, but no profit.
And suddenly domesticated itself.
Yeah, what happened? It's a very strange situation.
No, mine was very biological. My question was actually very biological. I believe that it impacts seed dormancy. I actually agree with you that I think it's a cultural person. I might be so bold as to
come. You think it's cultural? There's nothing else.
So the ground is a square.
Generally, no. Generally, everything that concerns architecture, although it's quite sophisticated, I had a PhD student, we're working now about the rounded turning or rectangle. Any architecture, until the early PPNB, is wrong. Any architecture after the early PPNB that is in the major Mediterranean rich zones is rectangular. And usually comes with flooring and plaster and a lot of investment. In the desert areas, they come together or it remains rounded for a little more, for a little while, and then our architecture becomes rectangular. What? Why? What's the meaning? There is a lot of literature starting in the 1960s, and a lot of ethnographic work, and basically, people talk about one of two things. Either it's easier in terms of technology, the rounded thing, and this is why this is the early architecture, and even when people already have rectangular architecture. And for example, they leave the mainland, Turkey, Ramdo, Cyprus, at the beginning. They may build rounded houses. And then they know how to build rectangular houses. They come from a homeland that was rectangular. So it's the natural way of doing things. And some people say that if rectangles are on rotation, subdivide, those areas, etc., etc. But this is all technological. If you ask me, it's not about technology at all. Because these people were doing these sculptures that are 5 meters and 5 tons in weight, and they were bringing them in one piece. We all talk about Easter Islands. These are Easter Island sculptures, but they're 10,000 years earlier. And they were moving them from the quarry side, etc. It's not about technology. They knew all they needed about technology. And if they would like to have a rectangular, they could do a rectangular. And if you look at Gebel Klintepe or another site, you will see rectangular features of many sorts that are not the whole structure, but they could do it. They had 90-degree subdivisions inside, etc. They could do it. It's not a matter of technology. So if you ask me, it's one of two things. It's either something to do with the structure of how this is books were organized. And the other thing is here, as usual.
Because I was kind of thinking about the discussion we were having about the changing world views, right? And just kind of how people would have to change their minds in order to change this domestication, actually start domesticating. So I was wondering if maybe you were going to tie like any kind of correlation between these changing world views and structure or anything.
This is contextually tied. Yeah. Because there's a moment. I'm
saying it's a matter of resolution. We don't have this moment because our resolution is plus or minus, I want to be large, it's like plus or minus 50. Even if you have very good dates and everything is okay, you have a big number of dates, I mean, for the statistics, it will remain there, plus or minus 35. Okay, high precision, accelerator, whatever you want. But there is a point in time within our resolution, we cannot see within our resolution, when all these things are happening. And if you put together everything that happened 1,000 years later, earlier, and 1,000 years later, you lose this, you lose it. So people change their architecture, and change their industry, and change their economy, and domesticated, and moved into a different ideology, or if I want to put it mildly, different symbolism. You lose all many of these analog representations, and you move into a world of human representation. All this happens there. It's not so simple as I presented here. It's not easy. Because these big sculptures at Kebekli-Tepe, if you look at them nicely, they are some kind of generic human representations. But if you go into a PPNB site, just every PPNB, just after this, in the same site, in the same Gebekli or in Levalichon, you got these T-shaped big sculptures. They're smaller than in the PPNA, but they have hands here, human hands, that are carved here. And this, then you see a person, but this also happens in the early PPNB. All these things are happening. I mean, you can say it's only, I don't know, coincidence. It's too much for me to see coincidence. Yeah.
Real quick, thank you guys. I had heard that figs were domesticated as an idea, but before we and some of the other domesticates we spoke about, what do you think about that idea? Is that unpack your theories all? The fruit, the fig.
That was so 5 minutes after we said.
So that idea.
Well, yeah, okay. Let's put it this way. The identification made of Parthenocarpic figs on the site of
Gilgal,
it's a perfect identification. Okay? So this is a fine example of archaeobotanical identification. The find is there, the date is there, everything. Now we come to the interpretation. Okay? They made a claim that since these are Parthenocarpic food, they cannot regenerate themselves, so they had to rely on humans to propagate them. Okay? And go one stage forward and say, aha, that's a testimony for systematic field growing, predating wheat.
It's a PPNA in the beginning of the industry.
But apparently there are, and we published a comment on that, and Tim Denham also made a comment in a different journal on that. You have to know something about the biology of fig trees. A female fig tree, okay, those the fruitful ones, they produce several crops or several kind of figs. Those that come very, very early in the season, or those that mature very, very late in the seasons, often are seedless. Okay, and then they do not need pollination by those wasps. And also, there is a possibility for a Parthenocarpic stock to be in the wild, okay, to be part of the natural genetic variation, as long as there are males around, and it can be pollinated by visiting wasps. So there is a biological option that those guys knew one or two or three trees around know, along the Jordan, or in near a nearby spring, or something like that, and visited that tree to harvest those foods. And this could be an easier explanation for the find in the science. If, again, and again, I'm not an anthropologist, if the science represents a cultural context of hunter-gatherers without any other signs of domestication, etc., this could be the explanation. And you cannot live by figs, okay? So it's nice, it's good to have, but you, it cannot be made a staple. I mean, I cannot think, it's very difficult to think about an agronomic system that relies on figs and lacks all the other components of statements. And again, this is something that, I mean, we wrote about it and we did not have time to discuss in this meeting, in this seminar. There is a logic to have a package of crops, okay? And again, some of those advocates of the protracted and autonomous model say, a certain community in the southern Levant, they have domesticated figs, or they have domesticated barley. Another community in the northern Levant, they have domesticated emco. Another community in somewhere else, they have domesticated maybe pea and lentils, and others. Now, if you think about agronomy, for instance, what is there any logic? Why would you need three cereals? Why would you need barley, corn, and emmer? Why would you need chickpea, lentil, and pea? Why? Why not? I mean, the Chinese, they had rice and soybean. Well, they had others, but this is what most people know. Why do you need three of each? If you leave aside the flax and you leave aside the bitter veg, which is not very palatable for you, barley matures early, corn matures late. Is ready. Lentil is a small stature of crop, doesn't require high precipitation. Pea is a late mature crop, thrives on high rainfall, and chickpea is planted in the end of the spring. It's a different story altogether. They did not have any insurance against barley. If you have all three, this is the best that you can get close to. So just one fruit tree. It doesn't make any sense. It is in terms of agronomy and in terms of supplying for your household. And not only this, when you have both cereals and legumes, and again, we didn't have time to show it, they have alternating response or different response to the rainfall fluctuations. Where cereals yield are high, legumes yield are well higher than the average. Legumes yield lower than their average, and the other way around. So what you get is, at certain years you get surplus from this, at certain years you get surplus from those, and this enables you to reach over lean years. So there is a logic, and this is also why Harvey was making those claims about knowledge-based and conscious. It was not an ecological accident, as Jared Diamond writes and others, you see. So, I mean, it's a biblical, I don't know the you know, how to say it in English, I can say it in Hebrew. You don't live by bread alone. You can't live by fig alone. Making the whole story short.
I want to add an archaeological
Iran
and other people in your science. Kilometer from one another. Both Gilgal and the Tiverton and other sites have archaeobotanical remains. None of them shows domestication. It's the fig only. That's one thing. Second thing concerning what Shachar said about not having one. The story about having individual domestications of a certain species is a very nice story, but there is no neolithic site that has botanical remains that shows one species. They all show a package. Sometimes four of them, five of them, six of them, seven of them, in many cases all of them, from the very early beginning.
You go to Chirino or to Neveri Chumi, and it's the earliest evidence for domestication, and they have the wrong. I mean, there's no site that shows one species domesticated, and then 2,000 years later, another site with another species domesticated, etc. It just doesn't
work. Even contemporary. One only with domesticated barley, one only with domesticated wheat.
No, but they say it's thousands of years, so okay, there might be a difference in time. It's not the case. I mean, the archaeological evidence doesn't show it. I don't know, to me, it seems...
And not only this, they argue for independent domestications, and then in a different paper, people argue, I mean, taking seed site samples from different sites and say that they were a meta-population. How on the one, I mean, if you argue for independent cultural, you know, context, how can you talk about gene flow and biological flow of material from one site to the other? So it's
contradictory. Too many contradictions within the thing. I know it's difficult to have in a mice population. When you study skeletal remains of humans, so you take PPRD populations from the south, from the central parts of Israel, from Jordan, you put them all together, you have a population. Why? Because you have, I don't know, a sample of 100 all together, and you want to do some statistics. But if you talk about autonomous domestication, and then you take other populations and put them together to have a good statistics, what you're talking about is, there's no reason, there's no logic, in terms of your own logic, not in terms of mine, but in terms of your own logic. You can't do it. It's just impossible. I mean, it's possible, but it's wrong.
Thank you. All right. I have a lot of questions, but I'm going to save those. I'll let you guys off the hook. But I just want to say thank you for a very, very interesting talk and lots of interesting ideas.
Thank you all very much.
A lot of great dinner conversation with us. I love very much the idea of intentionality, separating out crop.
If we manage to convince even one person sitting here, we made our profit. We don't grow lettuce the way they did concerning the other water. We need profit.
At least one. Well, thank you very much.